The following video contains spoilers. We suggest watching the episodes alone in the dark. Hey, hey, Wolfpack! We're back, and today we're finally discussing a fan-favorite tale of suspense from the long-lost underrated horror series, R.L. Stine's The Nightmare Room. I posted a vote up a while back to see which Nightmare Room story my subs wanted me to review next, and much to my surprise, our audience asked us to do Dear Diary, I'm Dead. I actually thought the Howler or Four Eyes would win for sure, but I was wrong. Although I shouldn't be too shocked, because this adventure stars Drake Bell and Brenda Song in it, together at last. Yep. Drake Bell, who was on the oh-so-beloved Drake and Josh sitcom, creepy adult Timmy Turner, and Ultimate Spider-Man, is guest-starring in today's horror story. Yay! And Brenda Song, most famous for playing London Tipton from the Zack and Cody series, is also in this. Oh boy, now R.L. Stine can finally complete his Zack and Cody collection. Since he's had nearly all of the Zack and Cody cast play characters in his TV shows. He's had Dylan and Cole Sprouse as a killer doll, Debbie Ryan as a mean girl, and now London as a wacky best friend encountering supernatural horrors with Drake. What's next? Esteban as a serial killer child molester? I kid, of course, but I am impressed at how lucky it was for these children horror shows to get all these big-name child stars like this, since it is a site of good hype. Now, much like Fear Games, I did not read the whole book to this one. I did read a sample of the book on iTunes, but never got around to purchasing the whole novel for reading in full. However, since I did see this episode with limited introduction knowledge, I can confirm that it won't be entirely faithful as an adaptation. I'm honestly thinking about not reading the classic books anymore. Since many of the TV adaptations were practically in-name-only tales, very loosely based on the original novels. Some of them do have scenes and character moments directly pulled out of the written works, but by the end, most of the Nightmare Room tales became their own thing. So I'll be watching most of these adaptations as standalone tales instead, and judging them on their own merits. If there were any differences between the books and TV versions, then please, feel free to point them out in the comments section below, since I'm not going to keep comparing the book and TV adaptations for the Nightmare Room series anymore, since I'm just done saying, "Wait, that's not how it went in the book, this is how it went!" It just feels like a waste of time, and I feel like more folks are familiar with the Goosebumps books than this series. Sorry, but it's just becoming a futile effort for me at this point. So with that out of the way, what's this special request all about? Well, Drake Bell gets a magic diary that can predict the future. But naturally, the book brings him more than what he bargained for, leading to some scary hijinks. A lot of my followers really loved this one, and call it the number one episode of the show. And we're going to see if it's still as cool by today. Well, what are we waiting for? Let's crack open the book and jump right in. Was this Nightmare Room tale an epic, mind-blowing horror masterpiece? Or should we dump it back in the recycling bin for toilet paper? Let's find out. This is my review on the fan-favorite Nightmare Room thriller, Dear Diary, I'm Dead. So, our episode opens up in a nice, peaceful suburban neighborhood, where we meet our main character, Alex Sanders, played by Drake Bell, who's just hanging out with his rocker bandmates. Pfft, Drake Bell in a band? That will never catch on. Alex Sanders is pretty much your typical Drake Bell type of character. He's a cool musician who's a bit dim and a real smart mouth, but ultimately a jerk with a heart of gold. So pretty much Drake Parker, but without any chicks or Josh in his life. We also meet his wacky comic relief best friends, Sean, the surfer dude drummer, and Tessa, a snarky jerk who constantly teases Alex, because tsundere trope. And as I said before, Tessa is played by Brenda Song, so I'm just going to call her London, since that's who we all know her as. And I actually forgot this girl's name until she became important to the plot in the third act, so she's London as a middle-class girl. Alex is bragging to his friends about how his mom is buying him a wicked new electric guitar for his birthday, which is unfortunately on September 11th. Oh boy, considering the show was on around 2001, I'd hate to see anyone who had birthday parties on that date. Anyways, Mrs. Sanders comes home with Alex's birthday present, but sadly, it's not a radical guitar, but a dull, boring writing desk. So his pals make fun of him for getting his hopes up, but then they have to leave because apparently they're late for their curfew. What? It's like 5:30 outside. I mean, you all see the bright sunny bedroom, right? It's supposed to be laid out for these kids, and they have to rush home now? I guess we need the kids to go home early to dodge those werewolves. So Alex sarcastically thanks his mom for the lame desk, but she's an idiot and thinks he loves his terrible gift, because idiot adults cliche. Hardy har har. Also, this is just a nitpick, but did anyone else notice that Alex has the Rockstar Games logo as a poster on his bedroom door? Rockstar Games? As in, the same Rockstar Games that made Grand Theft Auto, Red Dead Redemption, and L.A. Noire? Yep, a children's horror show is advertising Rockstar Games for 7-year-olds. That has got to be the weirdest product placement ever.
Jeez, the Nightmare Room guys are such sellouts.
Anywho, Alex checks out his lame desk, where he soon finds a secret key, which unlocks a secret drawer, which has a secret book in it. Wow, this desk comes with an amateur Silent Hill puzzle. Lucky family. And the diary literally has the word diary spelled on it. See, everyone? It says diary right there. Thanks for clarifying, TV show. I thought it was a diaper case until you spelled out how the obvious journal was really a diary for us. But when Alex reads the book, he sees it has bugs in it. Gross, those don't belong in there. But soon after, the bugs vanish without a trace. No. No, Nightmare Room. No, you can't get away with that. Where the heck did the bugs go? They've had to have disappeared right in front of Drake's face. Or are the insects magic too? Yes! But more importantly, Alex sees a log date for tomorrow, September 12th, where the journal says that the author got in trouble for causing a ruckus in gym class, but dodged punishment when a fire alarm went off. However, Alex assumes this was just a grammar error from a past writer's life and ignores it. But when he leaves, we see the diary putting itself away. Oh, well, that was nice of the magic diary to put itself away for the kid. I wish my room would clean itself up on its own, too. Oh, and it's not scary. We cut to the next day in gym class, where the whole class admires some guy doing pull-ups with one finger. Jeez, that's like Chuck Norris levels of strong. So our protagonist calls the jock a freak and humiliates him in public like a douche. Our hero, ladies and gentlemen.
Between no choice.
Question. Are we supposed to like Alex in this? Because right now I kind of hate his guts. I mean, what the heck? This jock guy is just minding his own business, doing pull-ups to pass gym class, and slightly showing off, and our hero just pantses him in front of everyone and mocks him. The jock guy isn't even a cliched evil idiot bully at all. He's just some random guy who has no bearing on the plot or any rivalry towards Alex. And our hero just embarrasses him in front of everyone. Wow, Alex is a dick. Shock of all shocks, he gets in trouble, of course, when the PE coach tells him to run 20 laps around the gym, where Alex realizes that this was what happened to the same guy in the diary. However, Josh Ryan pulls the fire alarm while running from Sting Borden, where the class gets canceled, and Alex avoids punishment when the school is evacuated, causing our, hero to learn that the diary predicted this very event. Oh no, Tom Riddle is trying to tempt Drake to the dark side! Later that night, the haunted diary calls to Alex, where the boy reads it and sees that it says the author failed a pop quiz in history class. Oh no, failing a quiz? That's the true stuff of nightmares. But enough of that scene, because we cut to Alex's band practice, where London acts like a jerk and trolls Alex for not having his new guitar.
What a bitch.
Okay, why the heck is London being such a troll to him? I thought they were pals.
Maybe she's not an Ultimate Spider-Man fan.
Well, that was pointlessly cruel, but then we cut to a history class, where we see that Alex has a pop quiz, which he fails because he didn't study. Oh, classic Drake Parker moments. Alex rushes home and discovers that the diary he has can predict the future. And as he acts excited about all this, Drake sort of derps out and goes through some really bad, bad acting. It's acting! It's acting! It's acting! Yeah, I think now is a good time to bring this up. Drake Bell's acting in this is pretty bad. Yeah, I said it. Drake Bell is surprisingly bad in this. Like, no joke, Drake misses the high drama mark a couple of noticeable times here. And it really shows. Drake Bell is more of a comedy guy, rather than a serious, fearful guy. While Drake is usually good at acting, some of his lines feel like he's really phoning his role in, or most likely, half of his big scenes were done in one take, and the showrunners didn't care to do it over again. I'm not sure if Drake was filming something else at the time, like The Amanda Show, but it feels like he's speeding by his scenes or just giving the wrong kind of emotion for an overdramatic horror story. I don't know how to explain it, but Drake really feels like he's rushing through some scenes or doing a rehearsal take rather than the real dramatic emotional moments. I mean, just look at these scenes and tell me they're good.
Sanders, that'll cost you 10 laps around the gym, sir.
What'd you say? Bitch, you lucked out. Diaries. Diary. It's gone. Tessa, she's gonna die. No way. I know the future. I actually know the future.
I'm sorry, folks, but I think Drake is kind of awful in this. For the first half. Yeah, Drake is bad for half of this episode. To be honest, he actually got better in the second half when he wises up to the diary being evil and dangerous. It's so weird. Alex pretty much feels like a dull block of wood for a good half of the story, but when the serious storytelling and tension comes into play, then Drake Bell becomes the good actor we all know him as, and actually gives a crap about his performance later. I'm sorry, people, but that's how I see it as. I think Drake Bell is bad for about half of this until he turns around and then delivers a good show. And to be fair, how can you even make this good?
I know the future! I know the future! I actually know the future!
What even is that reaction? Looks like Mrs. Worthington has competition. So yeah, Drake sucks for half of this episode, and while it did kind of bring the score down, here's something that really did guarantee some lost points. The acting from the extras. If you thought I was harsh towards Drake, well, the extras are much worse in comparison. Like, some of them have less than one line or a single reaction shot, and it results in some super cheesy or laughably bad moments. While I stand by Drake being hit and miss, the extras in this are worse in comparison, especially the gym teacher, as you'll all see later. Sorry, Drake, but this really demonstrates how far you've grown in your career. Back in the plot, Alex reads that the diary says tomorrow he'll make the halfway shot in basketball practice, where we soon cut to PE class, with Alex being called up to shoot a three-throw basket in front of the whole gym. By the way, the PE coach is played by the same guy who played the suicidal lawyer Ted from Scrubs. Perfect guest star to feature on this children's show, right, parents? I'm sure all the kids will know who this guy is. Also, not to recycle gags from past episodes of mine, but he also vaguely resembles the screwing around guy from South Park like the detention spirit did.
Hey, don't screw around. Screw around too much.
Teehee, I love that quote. Anyways, Drake takes bets that he'll make the halfway shot, and against all odds, he makes the net in slow motion, where we get even more bad acting. No way! Seriously, did nobody say let's film this reaction for a second take? After collecting the money for his new guitar, he soon reads that the diary says his best friend Sean will break his leg. Alex then tries to desperately save his bestie Sean, but sadly, he's stuck in slow-mo, resulting in Sean's harsh demise. Sean! Sean! you bastard journal! You harmed Sean! I shall avenge you, Sean, if it's the last thing I do!
Oh, get over it.
Okay. Don't worry, folks. The medic saves Sean just in time. But Alex begins to question if the diary is good or not. Yes, Alex, avenge Sean! Avenge him! To be fair, Sean is the funniest character in this, and his accident was truly sad. The next day, Alex reads the diary again, where it predicts a disaster will occur in woodshop class tomorrow. So we of course cut to the shop class, where we see that the PE coach also teaches woodshop. Dang school budget cuts.
Hey, don't screw around. Screw around too much.
So the PE slash woodshop teacher guides them all on how to use the buzzsaw tool. Drake fears that this is what the diary predicted. Somebody will get killed by the buzzsaw. So he runs away, only to accidentally cause the idiot PE teacher to get caught in the buzzsaw blade machine and almost die. Smooth move, Drake. I also have to point out that the PE teacher has a hilariously subdued reaction to the fact that he's about to die. Look at this guy's face. Is this the face you'd make to a saw blade slowly coming towards your head? He looks like he's accepting his grisly fate and couldn't care less about dying. Hey guy, you know you're not playing the suicidal Scrubs lawyer now, right? You're an endangered victim in a horror story! Act like you're afraid of death!
Mr. Murphy! I gotta get out of here.
Oh no, I'm going to die. I'm so worried. Tell my family that I love them. This is the worst thing to ever happen to me. I'll die as I lived, being a lifeless block of wood. Please, kids, help an old man out. I don't want to die. Yeah, see what I mean when I whine on how the extras are worse at acting in this? This guy is literally at death's door, and he doesn't give a crap. That's just so bad. Did nobody ever say, let's record that scene again? Because this is just so humorous rather than scary. The sad thing is, my friends actually told me that the saw blade scene was terrifying, and while I agree it does look foreboding and is shot intensely, the guy's subdued, restrained performance lessens that fear a little when he doesn't act like a person afraid of getting sliced up by a saw blade. You're in a horror story. Act afraid. Oh no, I guess. Drake saves him just in time, but this finally makes him understand that the diary is pure evil, and will force his dark future to become a reality. Later that night, Drake acts anxious at band practice due to the horrible diary events that happened, so he calms himself down by reading the diary again. Ugh, are you serious? I could honestly overlook this if the diary was magically calling to him again like before, or he accidentally read it when it dropped open, but Alex is willingly looking back at the book over and over and over again, resulting in him screwing himself over. He's causing himself to suffer just as much as the diary is. At least Dylan was stalked by the insane supervillain and forced back into the supernatural horrors. What's your excuse? So, what does the diary say this time? Shut up! The diary says that our kid hero will suffer a near-fatal accident while heading home. Alex asks his friends for a ride home, but Sean is unable to, and London acts like a jerk and mocks him.
What a bitch.
But as they pack up their stuff, Drake gets shocked by some faulty amp wires, which definitely won't be important for later, and he assumes that this was the accident the journal meant. Right. So naturally, he walks home alone late at night down the middle of a dark, shady ghetto street. Who the heck does this? I mean, even if he didn't have the Death Note warning him about all the bad stuff going down, what child is going to walk in the middle of a darkly lit street alone at night instead of, oh, I don't know, walking on the sidewalk? Seriously, Drake is just begging for something bad to happen to him at this point. You moron! And of course, everything scares him. And I do mean everything. What is he on? Jump Scare Street? How is this guy's luck so bad? But as you can all guess, walking down the middle of a dark street at night results in Alex getting run over. Alright, it amazingly doesn't conclude there. We soon cut to Alex's funeral, where his friends give him their respects. But in a huge case of tonal whiplash, his ghost picks a fight with London. Ugh, just shut him up and bury him already, London.
Yes, it will. No, it won't. Yes, it will. No, it won't. Yes, it will.
It was all just a dream, and Alex actually survived getting hit head-on by a large car. I know, right? That car headed straight for him, and yet, Alex somehow survived and is healing very quickly in his bedroom as his mother tends to him. I'll give credit and say that the mother is one of the few extras who is good in this. Since her performance is believable, and I did think she and the three main kids were the superior actors in this tale, so good work making the emotional scenes decent. Alex's friends show up to comfort him, where Mrs. Sanders tells them that he's still recovering since the truck ran half of him over. Yeah, the truck only flattened half of Drake Bell, despite us seeing it going straight towards him.
Great continuity!
Okay, I can get over Drake's silly Wolverine healing factor to speed up the plot, but I only wonder, who was driving the truck that ran him over? Megan. So the mom tells them that Alex will be walking again within 2 days. London thinks it's odd how Alex seemingly knew that this would happen to him, and suspects that he's hiding something. So she proceeds to steal Alex's diary while he's bedridden. Okay, I know I said earlier that Alex was kind of a jerk, but London is almost as awful as he is, and she only gets worse, people. That night, Drake instantly recovers from his car injuries and finds that the haunted drawer is missing the diary. Is the desk also haunted too? Or is it just the diary's magic manipulating it as well? Nothing? The haunted drawer is just calling to him and acting on its own? Okay then. The next day, Alex confronts London and calls her out for stealing the diary from him and warns her that it's too dangerous to play with. But London very smugly acts like a huge jerk and says that she can handle the diary herself because she's better than Alex in every way than he ever was, and that he's just a loser idiot.
Okay, didn't you? What? What are you talking about? What if I did? Just you have to get rid of it. I know it's cool to get a heads up on tomorrow, but it ruins your life.
I don't think that's gonna happen.
Neither did I, but it did. What happened to Sean and Mr. Murphy and me, it all happened because of the diary. It's totally dangerous.
It wasn't the diary's fault, Alex. It was yours. You just didn't know how to use it.
But you do.
That's right, I do. Face it, you're just upset because you couldn't handle it and I can't.
What a bitch.
You know, I think now's a good time to bring up that London is the absolute worst in this. Now, Brenda Song is not a bad actor, but she is playing a very bad character. After being forced to watch this story 8 times for my research, I eventually came to the conclusion that London's character is easily the worst part in this. I hate this woman. I mean, really, really hate. Have any of you realized what a horrible best friend this girl is to our kid hero? She has done nothing kind in this at all, even before she steals the journal from him. Think about it. London is literally introduced in this, teasing our main character and sarcastically mocking him at every chance she gets. At first, it feels like playful teasing between friends, but she never knocks it off and continues to make fun of him even when he starts to get anxious from all the supernatural horrors. Later, she makes fun of him for being too afraid to walk home alone down a dark neighborhood at night, resulting in him getting run over. And when he's bedridden from a near-death experience, she uses this as an excuse to steal his magic diary from him. And when he confronts her and points out that the diary is obviously evil, she scoffs at him and smugly declares that she's better than him and tough enough to use the Death Note wisely than he ever did. This character is awful! She's supposed to be Alex's best friend, yet she's done nothing to show that! Most of her nice deeds, like showing worry over her injured friends, are just so undercut by her stealing from Alex and smugly mouthing off to him like she knows better. This woman is terrible and super nasty. Are we supposed to root for her death? Because London is acting very much like Stephanie Howard. This woman is a very despicable person that we're supposed to like as a sassy, hot-blooded jerk with a heart of gold, but it's not working. She just comes across as too annoying and self-centered like a Tales from the Crypt villain. She simply sucks. So Alex storms off in anger while London brags about her ability to see the future and heads off to band practice with Sean. Even though Alex is in the band too and her kicking him out makes no sense. But once she leaves, our hero Alex very easily breaks into her locker and steals his diary back. Wow, great friends all around, huh? The only person I still remotely like in this is Sean. Bless his soul. Alex is about to toss the journal away for good, but of course, he absolutely must read it one last time. Why, Drake, why? You still haven't learned anything. And of course, the final reading he sees in the journal says, Dear Diary, I'm dead, making him theorize that London is going to die. Good, happy ending. Let the jerk fall. Oh, what? Am I supposed to care for her at this point? London is awful, and she deserves to suffer for being such a crummy best friend. Screw her! But of course, despite just fighting with her a few seconds ago and forming a rift in their relationship, Drake still decides to try and save her. We cut to London and Sean setting up for band practice during a dark and stormy night, of course, where London ominously plugs in the faulty wiring. But after we get an ominous, scary face of a pinata. Really, Nightmare Room? A pinata? You know, the sad thing is, this could have been creepy, but all it did was remind me of that weird pinata scene from the Aqua Teen Hunger Force.
Serve me while the pinata's over there.
Room. Sir?
Oh, ow! You're the birthday boy, let's just take off the blindfold.
Oh, am I here?
Me what? Oh. Hooray, me what? You hit it, see?
Hurrah! Where's the top?
Also not helping this tense moment is the pinata staring evilly at London. This is not creepy. The Halloween masks in Full Moon Halloween were creepy. This was just too weird. But before London can fry, Alex breaks into her house, since he still wants to save her after all this, and stupidly wastes time explaining things for her. Though, to be fair, my favorite character, Sean, actually does drop some intentionally funny lines into this.
You did what? Listen to me. He said you were gonna die.
Well, you wrote that in your diary?
No, I said no, I'm dead. I thought you said dear diary, I'm dead. Listen to me. We can beat this. It doesn't have to be right. You just have to be careful.
Are you two like in some sort of parallel universe?
Oh, that's our Sean. Never change, buddy. Alex eventually tells London that the diary foreshadowed her death, but then London sees him standing on a wet puddle of water next to some loose electric wires, where she very slowly puts it all together and tells Drake that the Death Note only predicts the future of the one person who's currently holding it. Meaning that Alex is the one who is going to die because the diary predicted his future, not hers. And of course, Drake dies for real this time. I just love how London sees that her best friend Alex is in a position where he's going to die a fatal death, and instead of saving his life, she actually tells him all the important information and just stands back to watch Alex electrocute to death. Really? You're not even going to push him out of the way or yell, "Hey Alex, move away!" She just allows him to die and uses precious seconds she could have used to save him to tell him the plot twist. Jeez, London is just the worst in this. If you didn't hate her for being a jerk, well, she's also an idiot and unwittingly played a role in Alex's doom. Why didn't she save him? And Drake Bell dies a horribly brutal death.
Alex, the entry's changed depending on who's reading the diary. That entry was meant for you.
It's fine.
You have pretty eyes.
sorry. I just had a nightmare.
Okay, that's not what happened. But we do get to our twist ending. We cut all the way back to the beginning of the episode where Alex sees that he's got a new desk for his birthday today. Where Uncle Phil drops in to explain to the audience that Alex Sanders is actually stuck in a time loop because of the haunted diary, and that he is the ghost that's been haunting the time-traveling diary all along, indirectly haunting himself and causing him to relive the day he died over and over and over again for all eternity. Yes, Drake is a ghost stuck reliving his death day forever because of the haunted diary. Wow, that's actually a pretty interesting twist. How about that? After all of London being the absolute worst and some lackluster acting, this story actually throws out an unexpected clever twist. Way to redeem yourself, Nightmare Room. Yep. Alex is stuck forever in a time loop thanks to the magic diary, and his dead future soul is haunting himself in an attempt to prevent his own death, but failing every time, causing Alex to remain trapped in a fate worse than death forever. And that was the end to Dear Diary, I'm Dead.
Wait, Drake is stuck in a time loop forever? How does that work? Is the diary some sort of time key? And is everyone else in his life stuck in the Groundhog Day loop too? Or is there an alternate timeline where they went on with life? How is Alex's ghost haunting his own diary if he's restarting in the present day? What's going on?
See, that's the thing about time travel, Barry. The more you do it, the less the rules apply to you.
I'll admit, much like Lovecraft's Woods, it isn't an entirely solid wrap-up tying everything perfectly all together, but it was pretty good. And my feelings towards this tale are a lot similar to my thoughts on Lovecraft's Woods as well. It's flawed, but overall a decent horror story. Most of the problems can be slightly overlooked thanks to the show providing us a clever, fun little thriller story, gripping suspense, and keeping the audience on edge for the most part. It's not perfect, not at all, but for the children, it certainly tried harder than most low-budget horror tales wish they could. I do truly respect R.L. Stine's talent for making superb horror tales for families, and Dear Diary, I'm Dead did have a lot more effort on the writing than some other tales did, so I won't argue that all of it was worthless. This horror story does have some intense scares, brilliant ideas, and a shocking twist ending that adds tons of nightmare fuel, no doubt here. However, my only problems stem from London's character being too unsympathetic to downright irritating, the idiot moments, and again, some of the bad acting. Drake Bell is pretty bland for the first half, but funny enough, after getting hit by a speeding truck, he does become a good actor again. Is it weird to say that Drake getting run over by a car actually made his character arc better? Because he's actually pretty serious once he recognizes the true danger of the diary. That could actually be a pretty clever way at looking at Alex's arc in the story's context. Our kid hero is pretty unlikable and goofy at the start, but once he realizes the Death Note wants to harm him, he does shape up into a better man later. So I suppose I can look past some of Drake's weaker moments, since he did become a good R.L. Stine protagonist eventually. But I really can't ignore those extras. Good lord, the extras. The PE coach and some of the side kids are actually worse than Drake's dull moments in comparison. My friends told me that the woodshop scene scared them the most, debating that it was actually scarier than the saw blade scene from Brush with Madness. To that I say, no. No, it's not. I agree that it did have a good idea and was pretty intense, but the one thing that butchered it for me was the PE coach's bored reaction to almost dying. Seriously, in one of the few good scary scenes in this, the guy playing a Saw-esque victim downplays the reaction of him almost dying. Moments with Drake and the extras giving totally bizarre emotions to the darker moments did cost this tale a perfect score, since I wanted to get more sucked into the story and see it as more than a cheesy B-movie scenario. And of course, there's London's character. This girl sucked. As I whined about, she does nothing a real best friend ever would do, and the audience might actually be divided on whether or not we should want Alex to save her or let her die. Not a good sign of the final act drama. The fact that she unintentionally aided in his death and allowed him to be stuck in this time loop in the first place only fuels my hatred for her. Though on the plus side, if Alex is reliving his death, that might also mean London is stuck in the time loop too, so that does diminish some of my anger. Other than the weak acting, idiot moments, and London's horribleness, this tale is alright. I think kids and casual viewers might enjoy jumping on board with it, and a lot of the great horror in this comes from how uncertain the future is. I was kind of afraid of how the diary was very vague about its writing, since it made the bad future events that big a surprise in the end when they did go down. The diary itself is scary, not because it's just magic and can cause time travel anomalies, but the fact that it has the power to foresee the future, yet treats it all as vague as possible so the readers can't fully grasp what awaits them. Its nightmare fuel comes from the uncertainty of life, and how the diary is so mysterious that we never fully learn if it's good or not. Alex's ghost being the one haunting the journal and trying to warn his past self about his own upcoming death, only to accidentally cause it multiple times, is a truly grand reveal and does add a deeper layer of disturbing horror to what starts off as a very ridiculous over-the-top story. So I enjoyed it quite a bit, despite the weaknesses. Dear Diary, I'm Dead definitely has its own unique style of horror storytelling. There's not too much reliance on jump scares or boogeymen being around the corner, but rather, a fear of an unknown future, and if knowing too much information that was not meant for humans is a good thing or not. Dark ideas, but all good concepts naturally. I did not hop on board the Drake Bell or Brenda Song hype train like everyone else did, but I was a fan of the story itself and what it wanted to invoke in us, so it did have good merits that rose above some of the dumb stuff. I can't really say if this was better than the book or not, but unlike the disappointments of Don't Forget Me and Fear Games, this one was able to stand up as something decent, especially since it provided enough focus on the story itself rather than cramming too much in or offering lame ooga booga scares. The episode was actually talented enough to stand up on its own, even with some scratches. This story is not the bestest Nightmare Room adventure ever, in my opinion, but it is certainly an exciting page-turner. So, I give this episode a gold skull. Dear Diary, I'm Dead is passable. The worst parts of this were some bad acting scattered around, idiot moments, and London in general. But other than those insults, the story is quite good. The horror is so thought-provoking, the twist delivers, the diary itself is ominous enough to be creepy, and you can tell that the show tried much harder on this story to avoid squandering all the great potential. So, I can recommend it, but will say that it's not as perfect as everyone praises it as. It's decent. It has a lot that makes it good, so it can overshadow some of the flaws for casual viewers and children. Not my favorite story, but most people can get good fun out of it all. What more can I say? Dear Diary, I'm Dead has a few errors in it, but in the end, it's a cool story that really leaps off the pages. Remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe, or just tune in for more videos posted here on Wolf Entertainment. I'm your host, Catastrophe, and I hope to rediscover a great Nightmare Room tale once more in my next chapter. See you all next time!
You wanna be free.